Welcome to St. Mary's Harefield's streamed service for Sunday the 8th of November, Remembrance Sunday. And welcome to a very scaled down Remembrance Sunday this year. We hope that this streamed service helps to make up for what is not generally happening under COVID-19 lockdown in November 2020. Well, our first hymn comes from 17th century Germany. Joachim Neander, a German minister, wrote about 60 hymns. He sadly died from tuberculosis at age 30. This is his best known hymn, which became popular when it was translated into English in the mid-19th century. Praise to the Lord, the Almighty, the King of creation. Let us pray the collect for today, for Remembrance Sunday. God of peace, bring near the day when wars shall cease and poverty and pain shall end, that earth may know the peace of heaven. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen. We're not sharing Holy Communion in church today. We're unable to hold services, in fact, because of the lockdown, and there'll be no services here at St. Mary's Church for the duration of lockdown. Could I suggest that we do something a bit different today than sharing a piece of bread? Could we light a candle When we come to the 2 minute silence, that may be an appropriate place to do it, or you could do it now. There are candles behind me which we've lit previously. To remember that light is powerful and it can light up even the darkest place, as we think of some dark things today on Remembrance Sunday. Our Bible reading for today is from the Old Testament prophet Micah, chapter 4 and verses 1 to 5. A prophecy and a vision of peace. In the last days, the mountain of the Lord's temple will be established as the highest of the mountains. It will be exalted above the hills, and peoples will stream to it. Many nations will come and say, "Come, let us go up to the mountain of the Lord, to the temple of the God of Jacob. He will teach us his ways, that we may walk in his paths." The law will go out from Zion, the word of the Lord from Jerusalem. He will judge between many peoples, and they will settle disputes for strong nations far and wide. They will beat their swords into plowshares and their spears into pruning hooks. Nation will not take up sword against nation, neither shall they train for war any more. Everyone will sit under their own vine, under their own fig tree, and no one will make them afraid, for the Lord Almighty has spoken. All the nations may walk in the name of their gods, but we will walk in the name of the Lord our God for ever and ever. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Micah chapter 4 and verse 3. They will beat their swords into plowshares and their spears into pruning hooks. Nation will not take up sword against nation, neither will they train for war any more. The prophet Micah has a vision of a different world from the one he lives in. It's a world without conflict, where the weapons of war are no longer needed, so they're destroyed and made into useful farm implements. Other Old Testament prophets also predict such a time. Jeremiah, Joel, Zechariah and Malachi say the same kind of thing. It's a vision of God for his created world, and people who believe in God and serve his purposes are given the task to bring it about and sustain it. Since our prophecy was made in the 8th century BC, there have been quite a few wars that have been clocked up and have filled many history books. When the 20th century dawned, there was new hope in the air. Our increased scientific understanding and evolutionary optimism might lead to a century of peace. However, it didn't exactly work out. Two world wars emerged, along with many other conflicts and genocides, increasingly affecting civilians. At least 108 million people ended up being killed in warfare in the 20th century, the worst century ever. So, would the 21st century fare any better? It's still very young, of course, but the phenomenon of terrorism exploded onto the world scene on September the 11th, 2001. Watching 9/11 in New York on the television was like watching an apocalyptic end-of-the-world movie, with people running for their lives through the dust as the Twin Towers collapsed. There are, of course, encouraging examples of peacemaking and reconciliation to counteract the negative story. And Remembrance Sunday is a time to remember those who paid a heavy price to give us freedom today. Going back to that vision of Micah, the peace that results depends on God. He's like an orchestral conductor that brings all the instruments together to play a harmonious tune. Micah chapter 4 and verse 2, he will teach us his ways so we may walk in his paths. Peace is a complex thing. It depends on so many things being in place. We can't have peace without fairness and justice, without people having enough to eat, or an equality of care and standard of living. We certainly don't have this despite strides forward having been taken to eliminate extreme poverty. A post-COVID-19 world has a few challenges to overcome, But the economy is destroyed and everything pretty much upside down. So maybe now is just the right time to dream that dream again. The dream of the prophet Micah and the dream of God himself. They will beat their swords into plowshares and their spears into pruning hooks. Nation will not take up sword against nation, nor will they train for war anymore. Everyone will sit under their own vine and under their own fig tree, and no one will make them afraid. Everything new begins with new vision. Our young people in particular need to catch hold of new vision and to run with it. Those of us who aren't quite so young can bring the perspective of the past. Sacrifice will always be needed in an imperfect world. The effective restraining of evil will always need to take place on an international scale. And no one will make them afraid, says the text. Today we're governed by fear. Let's try being governed by God and do things God's way. Maybe, just maybe, our divine conductor will enable us to play a united and a peaceful tune. The hymn, "I Vow to Thee, My Country," was written as a poem just before the First World War by a diplomat, Cecil Spring Rice. The poem was called "The Two Fatherlands" and describes how a Christian owes his or her loyalties to both their homeland and to God's heavenly kingdom. The hymn's popularity is helped by its tune, "Thaxted," written by Gustav Holst, part of his Planets suite. "I vow to thee, my country." The Soldier by Rupert Brooke. If I should die, think only this of me, that there's some corner of a foreign field that is forever England. There shall be, in that rich earth, a richer dust concealed, a dust whom England bore, shaped, made aware, gave once her flowers to love, her ways to roam, a body of England's breathing English air, washed by the rivers, blessed by sons of home. And think, this heart, all evil shed away, a pulse in the eternal mind no less, gives somewhere back the thoughts by England given, her sights and sounds, dreams happy as her day, and laughter learnt of friends and gentleness, in hearts at peace under an English heaven. The First World War produced many poets. Rupert Brooke was one of these, one of the early ones. In February 1915, he set sail for the Dardanelles. As he headed towards Gallipoli, he was bitten by a mosquito and developed septicemia. He died on the 23rd of April 2015 on a hospital ship off the Greek island of Skyros and was buried in an olive grove on that island. Brooke's idealized poetry expresses the optimism of the opening months of the war. People were hopeful then. His poem The Soldier, written in 1914, takes the viewpoint of a deceased soldier who sees a little patch of land where his body is buried as under the eternal ownership of England. The English soldier is in a blissful state because of this. But this optimism, however, didn't last for long in World War I. Rupert Brooke's The Soldier is often contrasted with Wilfred Owen's 1917 poem Dulce et Decorum Est, a very different kind of poem, and I warn you, it's not an easy read. Dulce et Decorum Est, Wilfred Owen. Bent double, like old beggars under sacks, knock-kneed, coughing like hags, we cursed through sludge, till on the haunting flares we turned our backs, and towards the distant rest began to trudge. Men marched asleep, many had lost their boots, but limped on, bloodshod. All went lame, all blind, drunk with fatigue, deaf even to the hoots of gas shells dropping softly behind. Gas, gas, quick boys, an ecstasy of fumbling, fitting the clumsy helmets just in time, but someone still was yelling out and stumbling and floundering like a man in fire or lime. Dim through the misty panes and thick green light, as under a green sea, I saw him drowning. In all my dreams, before my helpless sight, he plunges at me, guttering, choking, drowning. If in some smothering dreams you too could pace behind the wagon that we flung him in, and watch the white eyes writhing in his face, his hanging face like a devil's sick of sin. If you could hear at every jolt the blood come gargling from the froth-corrupted lungs, bitter as the cud of vile, incurable sores on innocent tongues. My friend, you would not tell me, with such high zest, to children ardent for some desperate glory, the old lie, Dulce et decorum est, pro patria mori. It is sweet and fitting to die for one's country. Wilfred Owen sent this to his mother on the 8th of October 1917, with the message, here is a gas poem done yesterday. The reality and horror of being gassed or of trench warfare, not knowing whether a new day would bring death or serious injury, is a very different perspective on war than that of Rupert Brooke. Wilfred Owen and Siegfried Sassoon and others challenged conventional thinking from the standpoint of suffering, which they really experienced. Wilfred Owen was killed in action on the 4th of November 1918, exactly 1 week, almost to the hour, before the armistice was signed, which ended the war. His mother actually received a telegram informing her of his death on Armistice Day as the bells in Shrewsbury rang out in celebration. It was not a day of celebration for her. Owen is buried in a communal cemetery in northern France. The inscription on his gravestone, chosen by his mother, is based on a quote from his poetry. Shall life renew these bodies? Of a truth, all death will he annul. After the First World War, Christians were forced to think through the whole thing ethically, and they reached different conclusions. We thought earlier about having a vision of a better world. The World War poets increasingly didn't have that vision, because they'd seen too much of the horror. William Blake, a much earlier poet, a bit of an eccentric in the so-called Romantic Age sparked by the French Revolution, lived in the Industrial Revolution with its dark satanic mills. He gave us a hymn which we sing today with gusto about building Jerusalem in England. But if we sing this with the hindsight of the wars of the last century and their horror, as expressed by Wilfred Owen and many others, we might want to go back to the prophet Micah to restore that vision, blackened and challenged by the experience of the trenches, the gas, the later Holocaust, and so many lives that paid a very heavy price. And did those feet in ancient time walk upon England's mountains green? As we come to keep the 2 minutes silence with the nation, you might like to light a candle as a sign of the light penetrating the darkness. We remember those who have made the supreme sacrifice in laying down their lives in warfare. They shall grow not old as we that are left grow old. Age shall not weary them, nor the years condemn. At the going down of the sun and in the morning, we will remember them. We will remember them. Let us pray. We give thanks to God for the sacrifice of so many who gave their freedom, their health and their lives for our benefit. Lord, help us to give ourselves for others today. We pray for the global situation with COVID-19, for our current lockdown in the UK, and for our diminished commemoration of remembrance this year. Lord, help us to give ourselves for others today. We pray for the need for resolution in the American election and for healing for a divided United States of America. Lord, help us to give ourselves for others today. We pray for countries today experiencing conflict, and we pray for peace, especially in Syria, in the Yemen, and Nagorno-Karabakh. Lord, help us to give ourselves for others today. We pray for those serving in our armed forces as they embrace danger for our benefit. Lord, help us to give ourselves for others today. We pray for ourselves, that we may look to God to conduct our lives and produce a harmony that will overcome our conflict. Lord, help us to give ourselves for others today. As we pray for those who are ill, we remember especially Astrid, Barbara Leek, Derek Weber, Madeline Adams, and Michael, and any others known to us. And we pray for those who grieve, for Maria Carey, Peter Matthews, Dick Moody, Anne Dent, and baby Leon. Let us confess our sins to Almighty God, including the sins of warfare and conflict. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, we have sinned against you and against our neighbour, in thought and word and deed, through negligence, through weakness, through our own deliberate fault. We are truly sorry and repent of all our sins. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, who died for us, forgive us all that is past, and grant that we may serve you in newness of life, to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, who forgives all who truly repent, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in life eternal, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. To mention a couple of things, I mentioned earlier about the fact there are no services taking place in lockdown in St. Mary's Church, Harefield, but the church will be open for private prayer and to find some peace on Mondays and Wednesdays from 10 o'clock till 4 o'clock and on Saturday mornings from 10 o'clock till 1 o'clock. Please do come along and find peace in this place. Our next hymn was written in the so-called 30 Years' War in Europe, 1618 to 1648. In a sense, this war achieved nothing except the determination not to have another one like it, another religious war like this one. It did result in the growth of the secular nation state, which would define Europe from this point on. A German minister, Martin Rinkart, in the midst of this war, wrote this hymn in a time of despair, warfare, and plague. Now thank we all our God with heart and hands and voices. During the early days of the Second Battle of Ypres, a young Canadian artillery officer was killed on the 2nd of May 1915, near Ypres. There was somebody there who looked after him. He was serving in the same unit. He was a friend of his, a Canadian military doctor, an artillery commander, Major John McCrae. The brigade doctor, he was a brigade doctor, he was asked to conduct the burial service for this person because the chaplain had been called away somewhere else on duty. It's believed that later that evening, after the burial, John McCrae began to draft his now famous poem, In Flanders Fields. In Flanders fields the poppies blow, between the crosses row on row, that mark our place, and in the sky the larks, still bravely singing, fly, scarce heard amid the guns below. We are the dead. Short days ago we lived, felt dawn, saw sunset glow, loved and were loved, and now we lie in Flanders fields. Take up our quarrel with the foe. To you from failing hands we throw the torch, be yours to hold it high. If ye break faith with us who die, we shall not sleep, though poppies grow in Flanders fields. Help us, Lord God, to remember and to be grateful today for all the sacrifices made by others on our behalf. Help us to fight the good fight and to live to establish the peace of your kingdom in a world experiencing constant conflict and very strange times. Lord, make me an instrument of your peace. Where there is hatred, let me bring love. Where there is offense, let me bring pardon. Where there is discord, let me bring union. Where there is error, let me bring truth. Where there is doubt, let me bring faith. Where there is despair, let me bring hope. Where there is darkness, let me bring your light. Where there is sadness, let me bring joy. O Master, let me not seek so much to be consoled as to console, to be understood as to understand, to be loved as to love. For it is in giving that we receive, in self-forgetting that we find, in pardoning that we are pardoned, and in dying that we're born to eternal life. So may the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son Jesus Christ our Lord. And may the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you and remain with you today, this week, and always. Amen.